Okay, so I have a couple questions first. Who's read the book? Be honest. Okay, who is coming to my talk tonight? Okay, thank you for your honesty. All right. So I thought to start things off, I'd just show you a little short video. It's kind of like the book trailer for Where Am I Wearing? That will hook you up with some images of and kind of an idea of what I did on this trip. I'm Kelsey Timmerman, an all-American guy with a wife, a mortgage, a baby, and an all-American wardrobe, right? Not exactly. My t-shirt was made in Honduras. My all-American Levi's blue jeans were made in Cambodia. My Jingleese Christmas boxers were made in Bangladesh. They don't celebrate Christmas a whole lot. And my flip-flops were made in China. I looked at the tag on my clothes and I realized I couldn't place some of these countries on a map. And I definitely didn't know what life was like for the people who made them. So I decided there was only one way I was going to find out. So I went on a global quest to meet the people who made my clothes. In Bangladesh, I went undercover as an underwear buyer. In Cambodia, I befriended 8 girls who share a room, 12 foot by 8 foot in dimensions. In China, I met a couple who haven't seen their son in 3 years and work over 100 hours in a week. Where am I wearing? This isn't so much a question about geography and clothes, but about the people who make our clothes and the texture of their lives. It's about the way we live and the way they live. Because when it comes to clothing, others make it and we have it made. All right, so I have a kind of an awkward question. I want your honesty on this one. Who wants to see my underwear? Anybody? Guy in the back's really scaring me. All right, these are my Jingleese Christmas boxers. I brought them along. They're kind of stretched out a little bit. Kind of look like a weight loss commercial at this point in time, you know? This is me before the Subway diet. Now this is me now. So these were the item that was made in Bangladesh. I followed back. I met a single mom who made $24 per month. Who thinks that's enough to live on in Bangladesh? Anyone? Rice costs $15 per month. You know, it's not enough to live on. And when I was in Bangladesh, I went undercover as an underwear buyer. And then I wrote a book about it. Let me tell you, you go to Bangladesh because your underwear are made there, and you come back and you write a book about it, you are an author. You go to Bangladesh because you wrote a book about it, or you go to Bangladesh because your underwear made there and come back and don't write a book about it, you are just some weird dude, right? So there's a very fine line here. So I have a question for you all. Where are you guys wearing? Anyone know without looking right now? Where at?
Japan, Honduras, China.
Wow. I think we just learned where his underwear came from. Anyone else know? Everybody check right now. Get some help with your neighbors. You can touch each other. Philippines. Let's just keep it to shirt, okay? Let's just keep it to the shirts. All right, so who had something made in Central America? Really, only one person from Central had something made in Central America. Who had something made in South America? Who had something made in Africa? Who is not very good at geography? I did not see very many hands go up. Who had something made in Asia? China would be included in Asia. Okay. Who had something made in the United States? Wow, so like only 3% of our clothes are still made in the United States. I know that really probably doesn't surprise any of you because you guys have a pretty rich textile history here. I read some of the essays that were written for the high school writing competition that were published in the papers, and like everybody's great. Who had a great grandparent or a grandparent or a parent that worked in the textile mill? Yeah. Who has a relative today who works in a textile mill? Really? There's one nearby. Yeah. So there still is. So I mean, 3%. We still have 3% made here. So that probably doesn't surprise anyone too much. Now, when I got back from my trip, people really latched onto this idea that I was an undercover underwear buyer, and they thought I needed to know everything there was possibly to know about underwear. So anytime there was a breakthrough in underwear technology, they would send me, you know, Kelsey, try these out. So finally I decided I would. And I tried out these. Anyone have an idea what these are? This is where the magic happens. That's like the first time anyone's ever got it. Who got that?
I read your blog.
Oh, you read it, okay. You could just say, you just fess it. I own a pair. Okay, so these are called gas eaters. They are anti-flatulence underwear. So I embraced this, and today I stand before you as one of the top 10 living underwear journalists in Indiana. Living underwear journalists. So it's kind of my claim to fame. But I tried these guys out, and I got them. I was like, how do I test these out? Like, I knew how to test them out. I wasn't just quite the setting. Like, where do you test them out? So I thought, an elevator, confined space, they better work. But then in Muncie, Indiana, the tallest building's like 3 stories tall. So that's kind of pushing it, if you know what I mean. And so then I thought, airplane, confined space, as the plane ascends, gas expands, perfect place. So I put them on, they go over your regular underwear because they are like so uncomfortable. They are like those jackets that wrestlers wear to make weight, except they eat farts. That's the basic difference. So I put them on, and I think this is a good idea. Then I'm walking towards security. And this is about the time where they started to do the full body scanner. So I'm seeing everyone going like this, and I'm thinking, oh, I'm going to do that. And they're going, and they're going to see this like carbon pad sewn on my butt. Like, how do you explain that? They just eat farts, man. They just eat farts. You don't tackle me and strip me naked right here in front of everybody. So I'm like, oh, as I'm approaching, I'm getting more nervous. 2 words come to mind. Underwear bomber. Like, I totally ruined it for the rest of us gas eater wearing, you know, public. So I get up there, and luckily I'm waved through the metal detector instead of the full body scanner, so I didn't have to do all that. So that's a little bit of underwear journalism. So I did exactly what you guys just did. I looked at my shirt. Do you guys have any idea? Can you place that country on a map, wherever your shirt was made? Can you? Because not a lot of hands went up. Can you place it on a map? Anyone have any idea where Bangladesh is? What's life like for the people who make your shirt, make our clothes? Any ideas? I wish that this is how deep my questions were when I set out on this adventure, but it was basically, I was looking for that next place to go, and I thought, I had this shirt, it said, come with me, my tropical paradise, and I checked the tag, it said, made in Honduras. That's where I'm going. My thought was more like, dude, I'm going to Honduras, more than it was like, I am going to explore my position in the global economy. It really wasn't that to begin with at all. Now, I think back when I was in college, like, how did all this get started? And when I graduated, my grandma gives all the grandkids $5,000 when they graduate college, like, sweet. My cousins were, like, investing responsibly, buying cars or paying off student loans or stuff like that. And I thought, you know, I'll just go blow grandma's money. And I worked for a couple months after college, saved up, added to grandma's money, and traveled for 6 months. And then while I was traveling, I started writing about some of my experiences. I got back, I had no money, I was broke. And I decided I'd got a job as a scuba diving instructor in Key West, Florida, where I started to write for the local newspaper there, and I got paid like $0 per travel column I wrote. And I pitched that travel column to newspapers around the country, right? Around the country, and I got into 2 more. And before I knew it, I was making tens of dollars per month. writing was awesome. But I really loved being that conduit between reader and the people I would meet traveling. So I never needed much of an excuse to go anywhere, and that t-shirt was all I needed. I was looking for that next destination, so I went off to Honduras, and I went jungle exploring, had a near-death experience with the fur-de-lance snake. One bite can kill 5 people, and it was like from me to the computer. Oh, it was terrifying. I taught an island village to play baseball, played soccer in the jungle with this one village, and had all these experiences. That's what I was looking to have. But then I decided I came here because my t-shirt was made here. The least I can do is show up to meet the worker who made it. So I waited outside of the factory for the workers to be let out because I wasn't allowed in the factory. You know, like I show up and I'm wearing the shirt, and like I tell the guard, like, hey guard, this shirt, it was made here, and now I'm here. It's like this whole full circle kind of thing. Can I have a tour of your factory? And like, no, you can't have a tour of your factory. And so I waited aside, and I met a fellow by the name of Amilcar, who, here's what I learned about him. He's 25, he lived with his parents, he liked to play football. Because I wasn't comfortable asking the questions I wanted to know. I think back to this sociology class I had in college, and we learned things about sweatshops and child labor, and I thought I never got anything out of that class. But when I looked Amilcar in the eye, like all those questions and all those lessons in that class kind of came bubbling up to the surface, but I didn't ask the questions I really wanted to know, and I think deep down, I really didn't want to know the answers. So I continued on with my travels, eventually ended up back home, and then it just really bugged me that I had no idea what life was like for the people who made them. So that's when I went to Bangladesh, where my Jingle These Christmas boxes were made. I went to Cambodia, where my all-American Levi's blue jeans were made. Went to China, where my flip-flops were made. 85% of our shoes, most of our shoes here today, are made from this one small region of China. In Cambodia, I met a room full of girls that live in a room 8 foot by 12 foot in dimension, and they work at the nearby factory that makes Levi's. Now, there's no such thing as a Levi's factory anymore. They just design and market blue jeans. There's a blue jean factory, and that's where Levi's buys their jeans from. But these girls, they make Levi's and other jeans that this factory produces. But they lived 8 girls in an 8 foot by 12 foot room. 4 of the girls slept on a bamboo bed, and 4 of the girls slept on the concrete floor. These girls, on average, support 6 or 7 people back home in their villages. So they're roughly your age, you know, late teens, early 20s. At the age of 26 in Cambodia, you are a washed-up garment worker. So you better get in your garment working years now because you don't have many left. You know, this is their world. They earn $50 per month, which is enough for one person. Like I said, they support on average 6 or 7 people back home in their villages. And in China, I met a couple who they earned $150 per month apiece, which was way more than anywhere else I went. And I was surprised, like all of our stuff's made in China. I thought this was the bottom. I thought that the price of labor would be the cheapest in China. But it turns out they got paid more. It's like, what gives? Well, I learned that the workers worked sometimes more than 100 hours per week in China at the shoe factory. So I got back from this trip, and you know, I wrote about the experiences. I was fortunate to be able to share the experiences in a book and get to come to places like this and share the story, and people have read it. But you know, the experience really changed me in a lot of ways. The way I buy clothes has changed, but I was never a good shopper to begin with. I don't buy a lot of clothes. My wife says I need to replace my entire wardrobe, which it could be take a long time for me to do because I check all the labels and where were they made. But you know, the garment industry can be part of the solution though. The shoes I'm wearing right now are made in Ethiopia by a company called Soul Rebels. They pay the workers there a living wage, which is 3 times more than most other workers get in Ethiopia. Those workers' kids get sent to school. Like this one job, look how many lives it can change. You take that out a few generations. So I look for companies like that have a good story, that actually provide good opportunities. The very first guy I met, Amilcar, in Honduras, I went back last November to meet him and to go back to Honduras to find him. I had no idea where he was. I didn't have any contact information for him, at least I thought. So I show up and I'm looking through my old notes and I found a phone number. And I thought, you know, I don't think that phone number works because I think I tried it before and it didn't work. Well, my translator says, hey, let's try it anyhow. So he calls it. A woman answers. I'm like, oh, you know, what's going on? And I can't understand Spanish very well, so I have no idea. And he's talking back and forth. So I'm thinking something awful has happened. And he hangs up. He's like, you're not going to believe it. I'm like, what? He's like, Amilcar, he's in California now. It's like, maybe I should have called the phone number before I like came all the way back to Honduras to find him. But I spent the next few days, probably 7 to 10 days with Amilcar's family. And Amilcar had looked at his life as a t-shirt factory where he was making roughly 150 bucks a month. And he saw that wasn't enough to provide for, he had two daughters at the time, and he has a mom who's sick and needs medication. It wasn't enough to provide for them. So he risked his life. He hiked illegally into Mexico, rode on top of trains, and rode north to the United States. He went to the place where his t-shirts that he would make are sold. And I just think that says a lot about like how much of an opportunity this actually is. Everyone I met that was able to get back in touch with from my trip when I did the Where Am I Wearing trip in 2007, none of them work as garment workers anymore. Have their lives improved? It's tough, you know, not necessarily. It's been a tough few years since I visited them. You know, the financial crisis, we stopped buying so much stuff. Millions of workers around the world lost their jobs. But then this is our role in the global economy, just to be consumers. That's kind of ugly to think about. So I try to wear a story. I try to support companies that are more transparent, companies that the jobs are actually good opportunities. That's one way I've changed. But also I saw the community that existed in these places. I saw a wealth of community in some of the poorest places on our planet. And then I came back to my home in Muncie, Indiana, and I saw a poverty of community. And I saw the in Honduras and in Guatemala and Uganda, all the places I've traveled, the people who make biggest difference in someone's lives, it's when it's a local helping a local, a Bangladeshi helping a Bangladeshi. And that really made me step up to want to be a local in my hometown in Muncie, Indiana. So I became a big brother, big brothers and big sisters. I started to volunteer with an organization that helps people who are living in poverty, matches up one person who's living in poverty with three other community members, and you help brainstorm a path out of poverty. Just became a much better local. So you all are local. Who's not from this area? Is everybody from this area? So you guys should be all plugged in already, you know, to who volunteers? Anyone volunteer anywhere? Where do you volunteer?
At my children's school and the Humane Society.
Children's school and Humane Society. Let's get some other ones. Anyone up here? Any volunteers up here? Yep.
Volunteer at the food pantry.
The food pantry. You know, we go through our lives and I think we live in this bubble. And everybody in this bubble is kind of like us. And we have trouble seeing outside of that bubble. And volunteering kind of really helps you see like what your community is actually. You know, the before when I lived in Muncie, I just interacted with this layer of people that were pretty much just like me. And now I actually see what it's like to live in Muncie from people from all walks of life. As a volunteer, I've met, you know, city council members and state senators, and I met people who just had their lights turned off and their water turned off and are on food stamps or are nervous that they're going to get the food stamps pulled away. And how much not buying or buying a pair of underwear, how much is that going to make a difference in someone's life? But how much can you help a single mom in your own community by being there for her? You know, that's where you can have a lot bigger difference. So that's one way that this journey has really changed me as well. So I encourage you to go local, volunteer. Also travel. You guys have a study abroad program here at all? Man, get out there and see the world. You learn so much more about your own community, about yourself when you travel. To me, like when I travel, there's like this little switch that gets flipped. And I start becoming much more observant. I start making connections with people more. And I try to harness that when I come back to my hometown, not just get back in that rut. And try to see things with fresh eyes and try to reach out to people and make contact and have conversations with people. So travel's meant so much to me, all the lessons that you can learn traveling. Anyhow, let me stop blabbing. Let me get some questions. You guys have some questions? Someone's got some questions. I'll blab more, but please ask questions. Yes.
And I do want to point out, we've got others, but there's a Costa Rica study abroad. I know we go to Europe and other countries, so they definitely have a study abroad opportunity. They should take advantage of it. care about society and communities and have some social stances, I believe, or something. Have you thought about running for office?
Have I thought about running for office? No way.
Kelsey for president.
No, that would be awful.
Ever?
No, I have no interest in ever being in politics. No, but. But anyhow, back to a little bit to the social like stuff. Like, when you guys graduate from here, you'll be more educated than 93% of the rest of the world. I think that comes with some responsibility. You know, no matter what you do, no matter what your passion is, no matter what your skill is, you can use that in a way to give back locally, to give back globally. I met dentists who go to villages in Guatemala once a year for a week, and they're the village dentist. Hydrogeologists that go to Africa to dig wells. I heard about this woman in Maryland who was listening to the radio one day. She's a hairdresser, and she heard about this woman in Sierra Leone who had lost her leg but still stood there all day cutting people's hair in Sierra Leone, and she wanted to reach out to this woman and help her in some way, but she didn't know what she could do because she thought, I'm just a hairdresser. But she went to Sierra Leone. She taught other women to cut hair, do nails. She gave them a profession. And those women taught other women. Look at this woman who just thought she was just a hairdresser. Look at the impact that she's having. So I think it's really important that we all look within ourselves. Like, what do we have to give? Like, the best use of my service, my time and my volunteer time isn't swinging a hammer with Habitat for Humanity. I mean, if that's your thing, that's great. You know, do it. But for me, like, it would be, you know, I would hurt people. Like, keep me away from the power tools. It would not be good. So I started to look, you know, I feel like I'm a storyteller. I share stories on the page and in person, and that's what I want to do. So I started a storytelling project called The Facing Project, and we did one in Muncie, Indiana that was Facing Poverty, where we matched up writers in the community with people who are facing poverty from a certain perspective, whether they're living in poverty themselves, or they worked with people who were living in poverty. And you know, it was this really cool thing, and it started this dialogue in our community about what it meant to live in poverty. So if you've read my book, you know, I don't really take a big stance. A lot of times people don't know, like, if I'm pro sweatshop or anti sweatshop, and it confuses them, and they think I'm one or the other, and I think we need to start with stories. There was a big debate in Muncie community about what percentage of people lived in poverty in Muncie. And I thought it was ridiculous. Is it 20% or is it 35%? I mean, and I always have, like, I have a stat for you. Do you know one person? Do you know the story of one person who lives in poverty? Let's hear that story first, and then let's start the discussion. So that's why I started the Facing Project. So I encourage you guys to find that thing inside of you that you really like to do that you could share on a local and a global level or at your school or whatever. So next question, please. Yes?
How did you approach the people in the different countries and villages, and were you welcome?
How did I approach people in the different countries I visited, and was I welcome? Yeah, I mean, for the most part, people loved to see me coming. You know, they were so welcoming, and I think a lot of it was that travelers, outsiders, don't normally show up there, and they think, well, they can't imagine what it would be like to be so far away from home themselves. So they just welcome you into their home, and you're, you know, sitting on the floor drinking tea. Like in Bangladesh, I turned down a million cups of tea a day. It was ridiculous. Like, hey, come and have a cup of tea, you know. And so it's just awesome how people, with so little to give, but they gave so much. I mean, they were really welcoming. There's this idea in our culture that we think that people don't like Americans or something. Like, it's dangerous for an American citizen to go out and travel. And I have not encountered that. The worst thing that's ever happened to me traveling, two things, I guess. One was I had my socks stolen in Hawaii. That didn't make it work. And another one just happened 2 weeks ago. I was on a flight from Houston to Indianapolis, and this guy who's 80 years old behind me threatened to kick my ass. So that was awkward. So I had to call the flight attendant, but that was, anyhow, he said I was leaning back into his space, and I wasn't even reclining my seat. And then he like hit my seat as hard as he could, and I'm still dizzy. It's ridiculous. I got, you know, this old man made me dizzy still. I'm very feeble. I'm a feeble man. Some other questions. Yes.
How did you choose your locations?
How did I choose the locations for where am I wearing? So I kind of went with my favorite items of clothing, but also with ones that were in a certain area that would allow me to speak to a certain aspect of the global garment industry. So like Honduras was just random, right? But it turns out to be a pretty good place to go for a t-shirt because that's where like 30% of our t-shirts come from. Like the most, the highest percentage of t-shirts is from Honduras. But so Bangladesh, it's really like it was a really booming, it still is, like emerging like industry there. It's kind of like a free for all and it's a place of like immense poverty. In Cambodia, they were trying to position themselves as a anti-sweatshop, sweatshop free, I guess was kind of what they were going for because they had some trouble in the past, like Gap and Nike factories with child labor and bad practices and they were trying to reposition themselves. And then China, because you have to go to China if you're talking about the global economy, you know? I went to China again for where am I eating? Because that's where apple juice, we get majority of our apple juice concentrate comes from China. Anyone aware of that? Anyone have any idea? Like you get a thing of apple juice right now, you look at the label, and sometimes it will have 7 different countries on it. Apple juice from Argentina, China, USA, da-da-da-da-da, you know, all these different places. Another question? Yes. Yeah, so how do you find like the companies that are making a bigger difference? So it's, you know, I get told about this stuff a lot because of what I do. And then I try to share it with other people. There are certain areas that you can look. There's something called Good Guide, GOODGUIDE.com, that ranks companies and products based on their social, environmental practices, and also on like their health impact, like on the consumer. So that's a good resource. I have a section on my website, if you go to KelseyTimmerman.com, that's called Kelsey's Closet. You scroll down to the very bottom. That some of my favorite companies are there. If you go to wearamiwearing.com/glocal consumer, GLOCAL consumer, there's also some links there. You know, it's just amazing, like who's had a church group or a not-for-profit event before where you guys bought t-shirts and gave them away? Or you've been given a t-shirt? Like everybody here, you know? And how much thought went into that t-shirt? You know, this group that so much ethics and morals are instilled in this group, but yet we don't even think about where the shirt comes from. So there's a link to a document called Practicing Our Faith in the Marketplace that kind of gives people advice on how to find those places to source from and things like that. Yes. Yeah, it's not really. I mean, their benefit is that they have a job, you know, and sometimes being a garment worker is better than being a not garment worker. But most of the time they don't have, I mean, there'll be benefits dictated by the country sometimes. So for instance, in Honduras, if you get fired, you're supposed to get a severance pay depending on how long you worked at that company. And it's like that in some other Latin American countries as well. But so often the companies don't pay it. And there's a big fight for that. And but there's not a lot of benefits to be had out there for the workers. The benefit is the job. Yes. Yeah, I think most of the injuries now tend to be like overuse injuries. You know, that just, I'm sure that they never get any help at all, you know? But there are like the one of the guys I saw working at the blue jean factory was a guy who sandblasted jeans, like his big sandblasting backpack, and psh, hung up the jeans and then sandblasted them. And it turns out that workers get something called silicosis from that, which is a fatal, can be a fatal lung disease. And I mean, they don't get any help, you know, for stuff like that. So, yes.
Did you find in your travels then, and now maybe with your current book, that any of these factories, people, any of the working situations are starting to unionize or form any kind of groups to, for their own protection?
Yes, so am I finding that people are starting to unionize a whole lot? So, I mean, it's, you know, the union movements everywhere kind of rise and fall and rise and fall. In Bangladesh, the workers' wages hadn't gone up. The price of food had gone up so much. So the workers were working, and they were starving to death. I mean, maybe not to death, but they were hungry. You know, they weren't earning enough to feed their family. So they took to the streets. So there was this uprising, kind of like the Arab Spring. You know, that was a large part a food thing. The food prices had gone up so much, and the people weren't earning enough money to pay for food. So then when you're hungry, like, you hit the streets, like, something's wrong with our whole society here, that the average person cannot afford food. So then people kind of stood up then. In China, you're starting to see workers stand up more, maybe not in official union capacity, but you probably heard of Foxconn, the where iPhones come from. You know, it's where iPhones are born. And there, like, the workers were on the, they took to the roof, and some workers were jumping off in protest. The Foxconn, the factory, actually put up nets to catch workers that were jumping off. You know, the one thing I always think, and I ask people, does anybody care about where our stuff comes from? You know, I don't know. I don't know if I believe it. I think for the most part, people don't. I think that we could, and we would, and we should care. And I think that the Foxconn factory is a great example of it. Anyone ever heard of iPhone Girl before? So this guy in England orders an iPhone, and he's waiting on it. He's all excited to get it. You're probably doing that thing where you track it to see, like, where is it now? Where is it now? Where is it now? And he gets it, he opens it up, it still has that new iPhone smell. He looks in his photos, and there's a picture of, I'll show you what there's a picture of, actually. Now, I'm going to Google iPhone girl, and I apologize for the girls in bikinis holding iPhones. Does not make sense. So here's what he saw on his phone. A worker in the iPhone factory. So he posted it on this website called MacRumors.com, and all of a sudden it had like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of comments. The media picked it up. Washington Post, CNN, everybody around the world wanted to know, who is iPhone girl? Where is iPhone girl from? So they traced her back to the Foxconn factory in China, which employs like a million people. And they traced her back, and the factory said, iPhone girl just wants to make iPhones in peace, you know, leave her alone. So I don't know if I believe that. But to me, what iPhone Girl shows is that when we see that picture of iPhone Girl, we see that sparkle of personality in her eye and a crooked smile and a crooked hat, we actually give a shit about iPhone Girl. We actually care about her. When we see the person, you know, I'm sorry. There's little kids here. I heard a little tiny voice. I was like, no. Sorry. So we actually care about iPhone Girl when we see her. So that's why I hope when people read my book and see my other work, and that they can make, I can help them make that connection. That these people are just like us. We have so much in common. You know, we share this changes that the global economy puts in our lives, and we don't know those changes will be good or not, but we hope, we share that hope, that our kids will have a better lives than ours. Yeah, so who owns the companies and what's the profit margin? I'm not sure about the profit margin. I think it's going to vary depending on the factory or whatever. With companies, it's really convoluted. There's always this like removal, right? So in Cambodia, the factory I visited was owned by Taiwanese. And they're making products for Europe and the United States. And they're employing Cambodians. The managers are from Taiwan, typically there. So there's always like this removal of like responsibility where something goes wrong and it's like, yeah, it's not our problem. You know, well, the workers lied to us, or, you know, I always say there's a long chain of players between producer and consumer. And anywhere on that chain, someone can take advantage of someone else, except for one spot. The worker's not advantaged in the position to take advantage of anyone, you know? So it's like that constantly in places where a foreign company will have a factory somewhere else. And Honduras, the factory was owned by Delta Apparel, which is a company in Georgia? I think it actually is. Yeah, I think it's in Georgia. Like the headquarters is here. But they're in an export processing zone. An export processing zone is kind of like this tax haven where foreign companies can come and not have to pay like much taxes in Honduras, but they bring jobs, so please come and pay our workers a little money and we won't charge you any taxes. So there's always this like removal of responsibility. Yes?
You talked about how much these workers work for so much of a salary and not be able to benefit for their families and stuff, but along that line, how many hours are these workers putting into these
Yeah, so the workers in China, like I said, work 100 hours per week. And often they would have to clock out and go back to work. And they said, if you don't do that, then you know, there's a lot of people in China, we'll just find someone else that will do this job. So that's how long they were working. The other workers, there's always, I think a little bit, it can be a better position for workers not in China. There's often a, what do they call it? It's not mandatory overtime. It's like, if you want to do it, you can do it. And so they work anywhere from, you know, I don't think it's like too crazy amount of hours, like 50 to 70 hours per week, you know? Yes?
What are some of the youngest ages that you found working?
Yeah, so what are some of the youngest ages I found working? So I definitely saw child labor in Bangladesh. And where you see it, like the big factories I visited weren't too unlike the factories that I visited in the United States. Like they were big, well, you know, well lit, you know, nice open big factories. But this is small factories. The big factories get orders, and here's another like removal of responsibility. The big factories will get orders and they'll take them and they'll give them to smaller factories. And that's where I saw like the things that, all the adjectives that you would use to describe sweatshop, like those are those places. I mean, they're like dark, sweaty, like so stinking hot. You know, like 150 degrees in this one place. It was awful. And I saw kids working there. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Kind of dreary factories. Yep. Yeah. Yeah, is there any difference between like the fancy labels and then like the other stuff? I don't think that there is. You know, sometimes made in Italy will, like, come with some value to it, you know, but it'll be made in Italy geographically, but by imported Chinese workers. You know, so it's a very labor-intensive process. The factory I visited in Cambodia, it took 85 people to sew together a single pair of blue jeans. You know, so it's very labor-intensive, and that's why it goes to some of these poorest places on our planet. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely. Like the blue jean factory I went to, maybe at that one time, they're just making one run of blue jeans for a certain company, but they could easily switch to, like I saw Levi's and I saw Old Navy. You know, and Old Navy jeans are probably about half the price of a pair of Levi's. So I, you know, saw that discrepancy there for sure. Maybe the material's cheaper, I don't know. But probably just the label's different, you know? But back to the child labor thing, you know, the worst thing isn't that we live in a world where child labor exists. It's just that we live in a world where a mother who loves her child just as much as your mama loves you and my mama loves me, sends that kid off to work for the day in a garment factory or on the street collecting some recyclables or selling some small little thing because they have to earn a living. There's just this lack of opportunity. The problem isn't sweatshops, the problem isn't child labor, the problem is poverty. And companies like Soul Rebels that I'm wearing right here, they're actually giving people that opportunity, and we need to find more of those companies to support. Let's get a couple more questions. Yes?
I think you'd probably be one of the first people to say you're a regular guy. But I think any of us hearing what you're doing and how you're enlightening and the wonderful impact that you're making would go, no, you had to be amazing all along.
So let me sum up her comment. She said I was amazing. That's all I heard, and I just shut off and basked in it for a while. Yeah. No, I mean, I'm totally just your, you know, like in college, I had no idea. I was undecided. I was undecided when I graduated. I was undecided when I showed up at the factory in Honduras, you know, and it turns out the thing I really like to do is tell stories, whether I'm good at it or not is, you know, I get to do it. People let me do it, so it must be okay. But I think whatever we do, no matter what it is you do, that like the woman who was, thought she was just a hairdresser, we can find that one skill and put it to use. I met a girl today whose father did had a construction business. What school was I at? I was at, yeah, the one that it's extra R, Armory. It's a mystery R in there. So I was at that school. Armory. I don't know, I'm gonna stop. So I was at that school and a girl whose father had a construction business here, she said, oh yeah, my dad, he goes to Africa, Kenya, you know, Honduras all the time, and he goes there and he builds schools. You know, so no matter what it is that you do, like it just happens to be that the thing that I like to do is tell stories, and I'm doing it in a way that I can talk to all of you who might actually have skills that can make a difference, like build a school, or teach someone, give them a profession. You know, like I don't have that capability. So to me, like if you have any sort of skill whatsoever, you're in a much better position to make a bigger impact on the world. Let's get one more question. Anyone? Okay, yes. Oh, it's tough. Yeah, is there any companies that you absolutely boycott? What's the worst company you can think of? Okay, well, I thought you might say Nike. Yeah, you know, that's the one that comes to people's mind first. And like, but they do more in corporate social responsibility than any other company. They list where all their factories are. Most places you call them up, say, hey, I'm thinking about buying your shirt, but I'd really like to know where your factory is. Whoa, no, stop the presses. You know, no way they'll tell you. Nike has all that listed out. They have their factory audits listed. And Walmart does a decent job, too, of listing where the audits of their factories. Now, it turns out that often it'll be fail, 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 but nobody's looking. You know, nobody's looking at them, so it just doesn't get picked up, you know? So, you know, the boycott thing is kind of, I prefer a more positive attitude of, like, how can we support people as opposed to, because if we boycott Levi's, where I was, met those workers, man, they're out of job, you know? Yeah, what do they want us to do? So I asked a girl, I was like, flat out, it's like, so some people in the United States think that you aren't paid enough, you're not treated right. And they said they shouldn't buy the blue jeans that you make. And she's like, well, if they don't buy the blue jeans I make, I don't have a job. And is she right? I think it's so complex though. You know, this isn't a black and white issue. If I had the, you know, if I could figure out how to make globalization work for everybody, like I would be president. You know what I mean? Like president of the world, maybe the universe, you know? And so it's, and as you're going into your college classes, I think it's really important too that you realize how complex the world is. When I showed up at a dump in Cambodia and I saw a girl who was 11 picking through trash, earning 25 cents per day, the worst place I've ever been in my entire life, like there's burning trash and the smell and the sight both made me want to throw up. It was an awful place. And when I saw her, I was like, maybe she'd be better off in a garment factory. And that like kind of changed the way I see the world totally. You know, it's I never thought that I would think that. You know, maybe this girl would just get a better job, you know? But this is the world that we live in. This is the reality of our world. So what can we do? I think we can try to support companies that are doing the right thing, you know, and how much can we help a single mom in Bangladesh? We can help her a little bit, you know, if we can give to organizations that support her, if we can shop a little bit more responsibly, maybe that will help her in a little bit. But, you know, there's a whole lot we can do right here in our own community as well. So.
Last one. Yeah. Just for a week.
Yeah, she wants me to take her son, who's 13, who thinks he has it so bad.
Because he hasn't cleaned his room.
Yeah, I think I should start like an international boys' school. Just like. We get. I can get one more question up there, real quick. Yeah, so are the people who work in garment factories, the jobs better than most people's jobs in that country? I think that they are not, most of these countries have a very small, anything that could be called a middle class, and they're definitely below middle class. But, you know, on average, you know, I think that their lives aren't too unlike the lives of the people that work around them, doing other things as well. Farming's really tough. So this is where am I eating? You know, so many of the people I met were farmers. They moved to the dump because they heard about the opportunity at the dump. You know, so like it's very difficult to make a living as a farmer these days. You know, and you know, there's no safety net for the farmers. They lose their crop. There's no crop insurance. There's no social programs that are going to help take care of their family. So it's yeah. And it's more risky. If you want to win a fair trade t-shirt, and if you are interested in seeing a sample of Where Am I Eating, if you text your email address to the following number, you'll be entered to win, okay? So that number is 765-273-3439. Again, 765-273-3439. So if you want your book signed, I'll be down here to sign some books. If you guys have some more questions, feel free to ask them. Thanks for coming.